Good morning, State College Alliance Church. Or maybe I can say that with more energy. Good morning, State College Alliance Church. There we are, and a warm welcome to everyone gathered here, a warm welcome to our folks who are joining us online this morning. We're so glad to be joined together to praise and worship our risen Savior, Jesus. Today, if you're joining us online, we'd love for you to check in, just to put a message in the chat there. If you're joining us here in the sanctuary, we have still on the bulletin a QR code on the back. I had never used one of these until I was on vacation with my wife, and they were everywhere, like for maybe restaurants. And literally, I held my camera up to it, and the website popped up on my camera screen. So if you've never done that before, I don't know that it works universally across all smartphones, but if you've never had instruction, me as the media director feel a responsibility to let you know, try it out, pull up your camera, hold it over this little box of odd-shaped squares in there, and it takes you to a sign-in form. And if you don't want to do that, there's also check-in cards in the back of the chairs behind you. You can put those in the drop boxes later on. So today, a couple of announcements for you. Immediately after the second service, the 2030 Connect group is having a picnic and doing some yard games. So if you're in that group or in that age range, if you've never been a part of that, we welcome you to come back and join in this afternoon. So it should be a great time with Scott and Jody Kartz leading that. And we just inviting folks to join in with that this afternoon. Also, this week, I am looking for some more folks to join me in a study through the book Sent by our own Heather and Ash Holloman. I've referenced it, I think, the last time when I preached earlier in the summer, or maybe it was in the spring. And what a great step into outreach and evangelism that they take it. I love what Ash says in there about not moving from a feeling of something I have to do to something that I get to do, a partnering with God and the work that he wants to do in and through each of us. So if that's stirring something in your heart, then send me an email today. I'd love to connect and see if we can join together in walking through and studying this book together. But what a great resource for the church that they have given. Finally today, last announcement is Alliance Sports Camp. I heard from Bill that there are just 6 more huddle coaches that are needed. So we're down to the last few volunteers that we're looking for. And really, if you don't know a lot about it, the huddle coach, it's such a great opportunity to pour into the next generation. You gather together with about 8 kids, and you don't have anything to do with the sports. That's directed by another person, and you stay with these 8 young children through the whole week, have an opportunity to encourage them, opportunity to pray with them, to do a little discussion on the teaching, and you have an opportunity to see. So my wife and I, we're going to be doing the teaching, so you get to come see my wife Emily and I just have some fun with kids and be a part of it as well. So we'll be there, but if you've never experienced sports camp, it's just an awesome opportunity to really be involved in connecting with the next generation. So that's coming up at the end of the month. You can go to the website, reach out to Bill. His email address is in the bulletin to connect and just step up and fill one of those last 6 positions that they need. Well, those are all the announcements for today. So we're just so glad to be joining together here. And at this point, we'll turn it over to the worship team.
You bet. Thanks, Aiden. I would invite all of you that are here in this room with us today to please stand. And we will begin with our call to worship, which is number 7 in the hymnal, and then transition right into all of the verses of hymns number 8 and 9 that follow.
Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours.
We give you thanks and praise your glorious name.
Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things.
We give you thanks and praise your glorious name.
In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all.
Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name.
Come thou, almighty King.
let's affirm together now in song that Christ is the very foundation of all that we do, of all that we are, as we sing together all four verses of hymn number 401, The Church's One Foundation. Spirit, as we affirm that indeed Christ is our rock, would you sing with us all four verses of hymn number 526, The Solid Rock?
Just a sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name.
say amen to that this morning?
Amen.
Wonderful to be with you in worship. You may go ahead and have a seat. We're going to look to the Lord in prayer at this time, and I would invite you just to lift up your needs before the Lord as you think about your family and the various things that the Lord has you doing in this season. So would you join me, Lord? We thank you. What a privilege. We give you all the praise today, God. As we are gathered in your name, Lord, I pray as we stand on the solid rock of Jesus Christ, that you would stamp those words deeply on our hearts. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. So God, as we look to you today, we acknowledge your goodness. We acknowledge your finished work, Jesus, that we celebrate and reference so often. Church, let me give you just a moment now as you have various needs on your heart and in your family. Let's take some time to lift those needs before the Lord, acknowledging his goodness, acknowledging his provision, and receiving from him. Take a moment even now as you pray. Jesus, as you hear the hearts of your people today, we pray that you would be attentive, that your ear would be turned toward us. And Lord, as we pray, we welcome the restoration of God over every aspect of our lives. Lord, we welcome the shalom of God over every aspect of our lives. We welcome the presence of God over every aspect of our lives. So Lord, even now as we come and as we look to your word together, we pray that you would meet us in a powerful way. Cause the hearts of your people to be stirred. I pray that my words would fall to the ground, that Jesus might be lifted up, and that your eternal word would resonate deeply in our hearts. We pray all of this in the strong name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Well, as we get into the message here today, I want to just remind you that in this season where we're coming into a new time of regathering, and it has been wonderful to be able to see your faces here and to shake some hands and to greet some folks, we want to continue to encourage you on a couple of fronts. One of those is that we're starting sort of simple. And so if there's certain things that you're saying, well, we used to do some things and we're not doing all of those same things anymore, some of those things will be coming back, but we're just kind of working our way back into that. So we're starting simple. That's intentional. So be patient with us as we continue to do that. And the other thing we want to just continue to really encourage one another in is that we continue to be in a season where we've got all kinds of different sort of comfort levels. And so please be patient with each other. You know, some folks may be ready to give you a big handshake and a hug, and other people may like a little bit more space, and that's okay. We just want to continue to say thank you for being respectful of each other, encouraging each other, not judging one another, but just encouraging each other as we go. We still have plenty of our folks who are maybe only able to join us online, and to those folks, we welcome you. We're glad that you're able to be with us today, and for those who are able to join us in person. We're trusting the Lord in this season for a new season of God to be working. And I'm going to ask you as we start a new series today for a little bit of feedback for those of you who are here in the room. What comes to mind when you hear the word rebuild? This is the audience participation time. So what comes to mind? You hear the word rebuild. Go ahead and just shout out what comes to mind. Restore. Okay, we like that. Restoring. What was that?
Nehemiah.
Nehemiah, sure. We're not going there today, but Nehemiah, right? Rebuilding the wall. Go ahead.
Slow.
Slow. Yeah, sometimes rebuilding feels like it's not going fast enough. I like that. Something's been destroyed. Yeah, something's been torn down, needs to be rebuilt.
Rebuild.
Yeah. These are good. I was reminded, thinking about when I first was dating Amy and then got married and came into this new family, and my father-in-law taught me a lot of things about working on my car.
you know? And so he just sort of knew how to fix stuff. And so when I had a problem, it was great, a great asset. I learned a whole lot of things in his garage, you know, and we'd tear stuff apart and we'd have things. And sometimes if he was working with me, the rebuild part was a lot easier. But every now and then I'd get hung up, you know, and I'd go find him and I'd say, I got these parts here. I'm not quite sure where they go. And he would look at it for a while and he would say, yeah, well, you know, the rebuilding part is easier when you're actually part of the dismantling. But he sort of knew how to get those things back together. And I appreciated that. When you think about various things that come to your minds when you hear the word rebuild, I was thinking about that a little bit this week, and I thought about the $6 million man. And if you were watching TV in the late 70s or early 80s, you probably remember Steve Austin, who was an astronaut who was seriously injured when his spaceship crashes. This is the review, actually, of the show. Handsome and athletic, Austin undergoes a government-sanctioned surgery which rebuilds several of Steve's body parts with machine parts, making him cyborg-like. And when Steve recovers, his machine parts enable him to have superhuman strength and speed as well as other powers. With these powers, Steve goes to work for the Office of Scientific Information. I don't know if that's an official thing or not. The Office of Scientific Information, battling evil for the good of mankind. Don't you miss when TV was just simpler, you know? Just battling evil for the good of mankind. Incidentally, Steve Austin had a big impact on my life because as a young little runner, I was always running, but running going ta 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 ta. And if you remember the show, you know what I'm talking about. Ta 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 ta. And if you're wondering, I did look it up. Somebody reported that in today's dollars, to do the Steve Austin experiment, the upgrades would actually cost north of $28 billion. So $6 million man is really nothing nowadays. But the show, if you remember, they had this voiceover narration. They would say, "We can rebuild him. We can make him better." Does anybody remember this? Please tell me I'm not the only one. Okay, we can rebuild him. We can make him better. So that came to mind when I was thinking about the word rebuild. Another story that came to mind, or another historical account, I was actually doing some reading on the Chicago Fire of 1871. And I knew that that was a significant event. I knew that that was that had world implications. I didn't realize that there were 17,500 buildings that burned in the Great Chicago Fire, a huge blaze. I also came across this headline in October 11th, 1871. This was 3 days after the fire had ravaged the city. The Tribune proclaimed this, "Cheer up." They said, "Cheer up. In the midst of a calamity without parallel in the world's history, looking upon the ashes of 30 years' accumulations, the people of this once beautiful city have resolved that Chicago shall rise again." And they went on to tell how there was an accepted narrative that the fire created a blank slate upon which the city of Chicago would be quickly rebuilt. And that blank slate allowed it to become a dynamic city with innovative architecture, a fresh skyline dotted with a brand new building called a skyscraper. And so that came out of the ashes of the Chicago Fire of 1870. Well, church, as we begin this new series, I would like you just to take a moment to reflect on the experiences of the last 17 months when we have been forced to deal with change, loss, frustration, new routines at almost every level of life, whether it was school or work or home, medical treatment, travel, play, etc. So to some of us, the title Rebuild for this series may feel a little bit dramatic. But I want you to see that as we preach through this series, we believe that God will reveal many places where His restoration is needed. He has always been in the process of dismantling the old nature and rebuilding His people in the image of Christ. And so we hope that this series will echo with the hope of 1 Peter 2:5, which says that you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. If you have your Bibles, I'd like you to turn to Philippians chapter 4 today. Our aim is to set the stage as we unpack this series over the next several weeks, and we believe we've got a lot of weeks of rebuilding ahead of us. During this series, you're going to hear from some other voices beyond just mine, as well as and including our district superintendent, Nate Howard, who's agreed to come. He'll be with us next month, and he'll be bringing a great message that I'm sure will challenge you. Today, we're going to begin this series by looking at the peaks and valleys of life and take some inventory of our need and some inventory of God's resources. So I want you just to begin with me in Philippians chapter 4. We're going to use this passage to sort of springboard us, and we will be looking at several scriptures today, so keep those hands free and keep your Bible open in front of you as we'll be looking at various passages. Paul writes this to the Philippian church. He says, I rejoiced greatly, this is verse 10 of Philippians 4, I rejoiced greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you have no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. And then he says this verse that we've quoted many times and many of us have used as a mantra in our lives, I can do all this through him who gives me strength. So may God add blessing to the reading of his word today. I want to say one thing before we get into our first point, and that is this. Over the next several weeks, as we address a variety of subjects that we're all going to sort of put under this umbrella of rebuilding. So what does it mean as we're rebuilding in the area of worship ministries? What does it mean as we're rebuilding in the area of service, rebuilding in the area of our community and our belong ministries? So as we unpack this together, I suspect that there will be some of the messages that really resonate deeply with you personally. So that not only is it a corporate call that we'll be walking through, but there will be personal conviction, there will be personal challenge, there will be personal opportunities for you to respond. In fact, I'm hoping that even today that we can have a deeply prayerful approach as we go forward, because we believe that really nothing of spiritual significance is going to happen unless God is infused in it. So even at the end of the service today, I'll call us to say, Lord, we want to invite your restorative power corporately over our church family and our community. So throughout this series, we want to call you to prayer, and that will be an important thing. So there will be aspects of the series that you will say, this was for me. This was really for me, and that's good. We love that. We'll invite the Lord's restoration in each and every one of those places. But there may be some other ones that you would say, well, I don't know that that is for me. In other words, I don't know that I'm sensing a deep need of restoration in that particular area. And that also, I hope, will clue you in that now you've got a little different calling. Your calling, if that is your response, is to be prayerful for those who do need it, because we're the body of Christ. Each one of us has a part in it. When one struggles, we all struggle. When one wins, we all win. And so this is an opportunity for you, even when you come to the places of saying, I'm not sure I have a lot of rebuilding to do there, that should clue you in to pray for your brothers and sisters that do. Does that make sense? So let's go together through this as we move forward. So looking at Paul's writing in Philippians chapter 4, he essentially unpacks this beautiful truth of saying, I know what it is to be in need, I know what it is to have plenty, and regardless of my circumstance, I've learned the secret of being content. The first point that I would like us to see is what I've actually written in my notes. I'm going to tell you something that you already know, and here's what it is. Life is not exclusively moving up and to the right. Now, when I say that, I'm talking about the chart. When you put the business flow, how are our finances doing? Well, things are going up and to the right. That's good. How's the attendance? Well, things are going up and to the right. Looks like the farther along we go, the better the numbers are going. In your business, you want things to be moving up and to the right. But something that everyone here already knows is this. Life is not exclusively moving up, and to the right. Paul says, I know what it is to be in need, I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every circumstance or situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or want. So here's the, I realized when I'm telling you something you already know, I probably don't need to expound on it a whole lot, but just bear with me as I say this. Every person that you have ever met, every person that you have ever admired, every person that you currently know, every person of faith, every Christian, every atheist, every agnostic, every person you read about in Scripture has had this truth or this reality. Their life does not always go up and to the right. We get the peaks and valleys. That is how life works. Now, when I say every person you read about in Scripture, we're actually going to look at several examples even in this message today. And this is a powerful awakening for me when I realized how human the characters in Scripture actually are. They're not super examples who got everything right, and they all experienced valleys. Sometimes valleys of their own making, based on the choices, in other words, that they had carried out. Sometimes, and often, due to circumstances outside of their control. So I want to look at several examples today, including the life of Joseph from Genesis. You know, the life of Joseph is such a fascinating one. You can read about him in Genesis 37 to 50. He gets a lot of text, and yet you can cover the majority of his life in one sitting. But to really take in the ups and downs of his life, you actually have to discipline yourself to appreciate the time, the uncertainty, the losses, and the immense difficulties that he faced in the valleys of his life. Betrayed by his brothers, this was a valley. Loss of his favored position, this was a valley. Sold into slavery, an obvious valley. Accused of misconduct, a valley. Wrongfully imprisoned, a valley. And yet when you get through Joseph's life and you see all of these things and you know, the dreams of God that are just not quite coming to fruition before the bottom seems to fall out again. And when we read this in real time and appreciate the amount of time that Joseph was growing and waiting and longing and experiencing loss, we come to this sort of climactic conclusion where he is reunited with his brothers who now have just realized who he is, that they are the cause, essentially, of so much of the hardship that he has endured. And so they fall at his face and at his feet, and they're crying out for mercy. And he says this in Genesis chapter 50. Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. There's something that happens throughout the duration of our lives, and many of us that are here, we've lived enough decades to know not only are there ups and downs that we don't get to always go up and to the right, but we experience the downs in life, and in those moments we have an opportunity for God to rebuild something in us that perhaps has been broken or lost. It doesn't make it pleasant, and it certainly doesn't make it easy. But I find this to be true. Perhaps the strangest thing about the hard times that we experience in life is that they so often catch us by surprise. Every one of us knows that life does not all go up and to the right, and yet when the hardships come, we oftentimes find ourselves saying, I oftentimes find myself saying, but why is this happening to me? Why is this happening now? And the truth of this point is that it's because life is not exclusively up and to the right. So we're acknowledging simply there's going to be valleys. Paul says, look, we're going to have times of hunger. We're going to be at times that we're well fed. We're going to have times that we've got more than we feel we deserve. We're going to have other times we have less than we had hoped for or want. But this takes us to point two, which I think is vitally important for us. That God is present in both our mountaintop experiences as well as our valleys. So if we can agree with point one, that everyone experiences the mountaintops and the valleys of life, this is not specific to the believer or the non-believer. The reality is that in the difference that following Jesus makes in the life of the believer, that is the person who has a right standing and a renewed relationship with the Creator, it is not that they will find themselves exempt from the valley experiences, but rather that they believe by faith that God is with them, even in that hardship. And it's easy for us to believe in God's presence with us in the mountaintop experiences. You know, we can sort of write that off. Sometimes we lose focus. I'm going to talk about that in a moment in the mountaintop experiences. But it's easy to believe when things are going well that God would somehow be with us or in this. But by faith, we believe, even in the valley experiences of our life, that Jesus is in fact present with us. The psalmist said, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, I want to make sure that I'm clear on this. Sometimes we experience have you experienced this? Just the overwhelming blessing of God's presence in those valley moments. I mean, sometimes it's just like the floodgates of heaven open up in those dark moments, and you experience that peace that passes understanding, and you experience the presence of God in a powerful way. Many of your lives have told that story. Sometimes God doesn't give us that in the valley. So we don't want to paint too rosy a picture. We say, oh, I just can't wait for my next valley because I know the Lord's going to be there. I know He's going to be there, but sometimes I'm walking that out by faith. Sometimes we walk that out by faith. But this is the difference between the believer and the non-believer. The believer is able to say that even when we go through the hardships, which we will, we are able to look for and believe that the presence of God is in fact with us. I've used this example with you before, but Romans 8 gives us so much, so rich. In Romans 8, Paul has just said in verse 26 that there are times that we do not know how to pray. There's times, and these are the valley experiences of life, we're so buried in our circumstances and things are so difficult and our minds are finite. We don't have the ultimate perspective of what God is doing, so we will encounter valley experiences where we don't even know how to pray. We don't even know where to begin. Have you experienced that? Raise your hand if you've experienced that. Well, I don't even know where to start. And yet there's a great encouragement with us that even in those places, again, acknowledging the difficulty of those moments when we don't even know how to pray, not even sure where to start, the Holy Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. So with that deep and basement level, God is present. In fact, the Holy Spirit is interceding for us. That's an incredible promise. And then, in a way that I didn't notice for so many years, right after that, Paul says, so all these things that we don't know, and then verse 28, but then we do know that God is working all things for the good of those who love Him. So sometimes in our valleys, we get it. Sometimes we don't. Sometimes we see it clearly. I see what God is doing. And even though this is painful, I get it and I see it. Praise the Lord for that. Other times we say, I have no idea what the Lord is doing right now. I don't get it. I know that it hurts. I know that it's not fun. But in faith, I'm believing for the things that I cannot see. Scripture demonstrates the frequent reality of both mountaintop experiences and valley experiences that shape the character and the direction of the individual. So I don't know if you know this, but right now God is shaping in the places that you're saying, boy, I really need some rebuilding. I really need the restorative work of the Lord. Boy, I really feel like I'm in the valley in this area of my life. It is in those very areas that God may use those circumstances to shape the character of the individual as well as the direction. Let me give you another example. Like this one's so sort of on the nose and plain to us, but powerful story in 1 Kings in chapter 18. If you're taking notes, you can jot that down. This is the account of Elijah, literally on the mountain. He's on Mount Carmel, and he's got such a swagger. You know, I mean, you can't read through that without seeing the confidence you know, that he is just brimming with as he is expecting God to do a miraculous thing. And this is the whole thing. He says, you know, just go ahead and douse my offering with as much water and stuff. Douse it again. And so, I mean, he's just walking with this confidence. And he prays out to the Lord, the one who answers by fire. He is God. And bam, the fire of God falls down, and God has showed himself victorious. I mean, this is a moment on the mountain, literally, for Elijah. You go to the very next chapter. The very next chapter. 1 Kings chapter 19. Verses 3 to 5. Then he was afraid. He arose and he ran for his life. He came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah. And he left his servants there. And he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. And he came and he sat down under a broom tree. And he asked that he might die, saying, "It is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life, for I'm no better than my father's." And he lay down and he slept under a broom tree. And then an angel had to come and touch him and say, "Get up and eat something." So here we have this guy with this mountaintop experience of just seeing God show up in a powerful way, brimming with confidence in what God can do through him and around him and everything else. And a chapter later, he's saying he's in the valley. He's afraid. He's overwhelmed. He's given up. He's a little whiny. But we'll give him a pass. He's going through a lot. So we see this example all throughout Scripture. God is present in the mountaintops and the valleys. Now, it's after that valley experience that we get this beautiful encounter of Elijah learning to listen for the voice of God. And you remember the story. So, you know, the big firestorm goes by and the tornado goes by and everything. But then there's a small whisper. And the Lord was in that small whisper, the still small voice of the Lord. So again and again, we see throughout Scripture. I mean, again, I could give you dozens of examples, but we would be here till dinner time, and so I'm going to keep us moving. But the point is simply this, that God is present in our mountaintops, and God is present in our valleys. Let's move on to our third one. Our third point is this. We learn differently on the mountain. So if we can be in agreement that life is going to do this, it's going to have ups and downs. The beauty of following Christ is that as life does this and it has its ups and downs, we believe that God is with us at each of those intervals and in the in-betweens as well. So there's this doing life with the Lord, but we are learning at each of these intervals as well. And so point three is simply this. We learn differently on the mountain. We have a different perspective. We can see things in a different way. I don't know if any of you are outdoors enthusiasts, but my family, we like to be outdoors. And, you know, in this season of pandemic, I think we hiked every trail we could find in this county twice. I mean, we did a lot of hiking. We enjoy doing that, you know. So we had lots of opportunities to be outside, and so we did that. In March of this year, we took a little trip for a couple of days to Shenandoah National Forest down in Virginia. We've driven by there a handful of times. We've never been there, and so we said, "Hey, let's go down there." Anybody been to Shenandoah? Probably a handful of us have been there once, twice, or another. Okay, so we were there for a couple of days, and we were looking for some good hikes, and I kept coming back to this hike called Old Rag Trail, Old Rag Mountain Trail, I think it was called, and I looked it up, and it was getting all the best reviews. All of these five-star reviews. Everyone said, "Oh man, it's incredible! It's long, but it's worth it. This is like a 10-mile hike. It's pretty good, pretty rigorous, you know." So we're hiking up this mountain, and so we decided we'd do it. Incidentally, it did get one-star review too. So then I was like, "Ah, let's figure out what's wrong with this." And so the one-star reviewer actually wrote, "This was in fact the best hike in Shenandoah National Forest, but it has the weirdest name, and so I give it one star." Come on. That was true. It did have a weird name. But anyway, so we did it, and we did this hike it was a very foggy day. There was this rolling fog that would come through really thick at various times that we were down there, and on this particular day it was really thick. So we were hiking up through the fog to get to the summit of this trail. It did end up being just an incredible trail. If you've ever been down there, or if you've hiked that, if anyone's hiked that, certainly share your war stories with me afterwards, because it was definitely worth the 10 miles and the many hours that it took us to do it. But this is the part that was interesting. I brought a picture. I want you to see this picture. As we got up through this fog, normally this is where you would look out over the whole valley and you'd see all the trees. I mean, you'd see for miles and miles and miles. And what you could see here was actually, this was the fog that we hiked through. But we actually hiked up to a point that we got out of it and over it, and we were able to look down. That was sort of a unique experience, and though we missed the neat view, it was kind of a unique picture for us. And so we took that, looking down on the clouds. It almost looked like we were flying. But I share that with you today because on the mountain, and in the mountaintop experiences of life, you know, that's oftentimes where we catch the vision. That's where we catch the vision for, you know, what God's doing next, what God's doing now, what God is calling us to. In fact, I was thinking about in Matthew chapter 7, just to give you another scriptural example here this morning. Matthew chapter 7 records the transfiguration of Christ, and it actually reads this way. If you want to flip over there, you can, the first few verses of the chapter. It says, after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John, and he led them up a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there also appeared Moses and Elijah talking with him. Again, this is a scriptural experience that's probably hard to even get our minds around, but essentially what the disciples were witnessing was the restoration of God, essentially the new body of Christ, the resurrected Christ in advance, if you will. And so seeing the glory of God in this incredible way, and then they have this conversation, you know, can we stay here? Can we make tents? And then there's the bright cloud overshadows them, and a voice from the cloud says, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. And the experience, again, we read this sort of like, oh yeah, it happened. They were on the mountain and this happened. But the experience was so overwhelming that verse 6 says, when the disciples heard this, they fell on their face. I mean, this was not a dignified, you know, worship service where, okay, we're in the presence of the Lord. And this is FaceTime in the presence of Almighty God. And Jesus has to kind of get them up and tell them, you know, get up, don't be afraid. And they lifted up their eyes, and then it was only Jesus again. I imagine that experience, I can't quite get my mind around it, but I imagine that experience anchored their ministry for the rest of their lives. In fact, Peter writes in 2 Peter, I think it's verse chapter 1, 16 to 18, Peter writes about this. He says, we saw Jesus transfigured. We saw his glory. And it kept them anchored. So we learn differently on the mountain. And I guess I would say this, you know, because some of us are, maybe you're experiencing some mountaintop experiences even now in life when, you know, a lot of us are talking about rebuilding, but maybe you're at a place where you're saying, hey, you know, the Lord's been really meeting me in some powerful ways and doing some significant things, mountaintop kind of things. I would suggest to you this way, that every mountaintop is an opportunity for us to express gratitude. Every mountaintop is an opportunity for us to learn humility, because you get to the place where you kind of see some things you couldn't see before. You get a fresh perspective, and you realize how far you've come, and yet it keeps you humble because you realize this is how far the Lord has led you. This is how far the Lord has allowed you to come. And then you gain a faith-filled perspective. You know, you're able to see things in those experiences that will then fuel the vision as you go forward. So point three simply is that we learn differently on the mountain. And point four is really where I'd like us to go here today as we start this series. Point four is we learn differently in the valley. We learn differently in the valley. Let me ask you, what happens in your life when things get shaken up? Some of the things that I have found to be true is this, that the more apparent the loss or the trial, the deeper my prayer life actually becomes. I wish that I didn't always necessarily need those shakeups for that to be true, but I have found it very much to be true. I've also found what happens when things get shaken up. Our appreciation becomes deeper. And I think in some ways we prioritize much better. I was recently, you know, getting some feedback. This was when we were doing some worship on the outdoors there. And, you know, so much of my questioning and kind of feedback with people is, you know, who's happy with this or who doesn't like that or could we do this better that would be, you know, et cetera. And so we're having those kind of conversations, trying to serve well, trying to meet as many needs as we can. And one of the people that was in the discussion, a member of our church here, who happens to be going through an incredibly difficult time. I know this to be true. Incredibly difficult season, health and everything else. And his feedback was this: I'm just so happy to be in the presence of the Lord. I'm just happy to be in the presence of the Lord. And then he even said, I think in reference to the other pieces that we were trying to factor in, well, what about this? Or could we do this differently or better? Were people okay with this? Da, 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 da. And he just said, I think I'm just in a little different place than all that. I'm just happy to be in the presence of the Lord. He's in the middle of the valley, but he's appreciating deeply just being in the presence of the Lord, just being with his church family in worship. Every valley presents an opportunity. A couple other things that happen when our world gets shaken up, I think we become wiser, or at least we have the opportunity to. When my world gets shaken up, new life is able to emerge. You know, I was thinking about that with the story of Chicago. They were able to do new things, to take a new attempt at things. So new life is able to emerge. But we learn differently in the valley. The psalmist said this in Psalm 77 as he's lamenting the difficulties in the valleys that he's walking through and even asking very honestly the question, has the Lord forgotten me? You know, has the Lord forgotten me? Has his mercy essentially run out? And then Psalm 77, verses 10 to 12 says this. He says, then I thought, to this I will appeal, the years when the Most High stretched out his right hand. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will consider all of your works, and I will meditate on all your mighty deeds. You know, sometimes one of the most beautiful things that happens when we get those valley circumstances and we're shaken up in a significant way and our faith is shaken is that we would say, I remember the work that God has done. That's exactly what the psalmist is doing here. In the midst of despair, instead of giving into that despair in the midst of the valley, he says, I will consider your works. I will meditate on all your mighty deeds. Just a moment ago, I said that every mountaintop is an opportunity to express gratitude, learn humility, and gain a faith-filled perspective, probably among a dozen other things. I would also say this, every valley presents an opportunity to grieve our losses, to evaluate our priorities, and to receive the restorative power of God. Job said this to his wife when she criticized him. He said, shall we accept good from God and not trouble? This is life. In his case, quite extreme. Oswald Chambers said this. I love this quote. He says, God gives us the vision, and then he takes us down to the valley to batter us into the shape of the vision. And it is in the valley that so many of us faint and give way, but every vision will be made real if we have patience. You see, it's in this valley that we learn to pursue the presence of God more fully. I don't know if you've been in a situation even in this last year, this last season, where we've had so much shakeup and so much difficulty and so much difference and so much frustration and everything, but I've come to the point many times where I've said, Lord, we just need more of your presence. And whatever we do moving forward, wherever God leads us, whatever new initiatives take root, whatever old structures get rebuilt, I will tell you this, that we will thrive based on our ability to pursue the presence of God. And I'm going to give you one last scriptural example. I told you I was going to give you several today, but this one's so beautiful. and I think sets the tone so nicely for where our hearts may be as we start this rebuilding series. In Exodus chapter 33, Moses is talking with God. He had some ups and downs, you may recall. Moses says this. He says, if you're pleased with me, teach me your way so I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Remember that this nation is your people. See, he had a good perspective. That's a good starting place. And then he says, the Lord replied, my presence will go with you and will give you rest. You see, church, that is the promise that if we can get our minds around, get our hands on that, get our hearts into that place, the promise of God, my presence will go with you and give you rest. That is a blessing. That is a blessing. In the midst of uncertainty, in the midst of difficulty or whatever, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. And then Moses said to him, I love this, he's sort of doubling down here. Moses said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. I like that. There's a boldness to that. We don't tell God what to do, but I think there are times that we can say, Lord, here's the reality, and you already know it. I'm only agreeing with you. If we don't have your presence, we don't have anything to offer. We will be a dried up gathering of people who come together and sing songs and say hello and do things. But if we don't have your presence, we will never be the church that you want us to be. And Moses is saying, if we don't have your presence, we'll never be the people that you want us to be. And he goes on to say, how will anyone know that you're pleased with me and with the people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the faces of the earth? And the Lord said to Moses, I will do the very thing you have asked. Because I am pleased with you, and I know you by name. And then Moses says, now show me your glory. Man, that is awesome. That whole exchange is so powerful. As we get ready to conclude the service, the invitation will be simply this. I would love it if as a church family today, we might, as an expression of our desire for the restoration of God in us, in our church, in our new season, in our community, etc., and in various things that maybe the Lord would speak to you, I would love it if you would have the courage to say corporately, Lord, we need more of your presence. And we're here waiting on you. We're asking. We're asking for you to do work beyond our capacity. Because if we are only the sum of our best efforts, we'll never be the church that God wants us to be. So it's sort of a simple ask. And if you're comfortable, you can come pray here. I think that's a wonderful expression when we can do that, sort of get out of our space and say, Lord, we're coming. If you don't feel comfortable being close with other people, we want to be respectful of that. Maybe you want to sit on the front or just... But I think that posture of receiving from him, seeking him, asking him, Lord, we need more of your presence. Maybe the Lord would stir us in that direction today. I'm going to give one last example as we close. We started with the great Chicago fire of 1871, and I was thinking as I wrote this message, I thought, you know what, there's something else I heard about that. There's something else I heard about that. And then I remembered, yeah, the story of Horatio Spafford. Remember that? Horatio Spafford was the author who wrote, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say it is well with my soul. And I went back and I kind of looked him up and I was like, yeah, this was his time frame. He wrote that in 1873. He lost his fortune, you know, his money in the Chicago fire. He lost that. He lost family members in close conjunction with that, and then a fateful sea ocean vessel that sank, and four of his daughters died. His wife wrote a famous telegram to him that simply said, "Saved alone." Oh. You know, so here he is in the midst of grief and loss and hardship of all kinds. Life does this, right? Ups and downs. And he penned this beautiful hymn that has been an anchor for so many of us, an encouragement for so many of us in our times of trial. We're not going to sing that hymn right now. We're going to sing another hymn that I think is equally good. But as we do that, I want to just encourage us to pray. In fact, maybe we could even begin to move now, if you would be so inclined to say, you know what, we're inviting the restorative power of God. We want to begin this journey in that perspective. I'm going to ask if you would stand first with me, and as I begin to pray, if that's sort of your heart, you say, you know what, I'm going to go after that. Lord's moving me to say, praying for more of that. I would just ask you if you would just join me kind of up here. Again, if you're not comfortable up here, that's okay. Join me in spirit. But you could begin to move even as we pray, and we're going to ask the Lord together for his restorative presence. So begin to come forward as the Lord stirs your heart. Jesus, we thank you right now. I pray that you would activate your church. Lord, I pray that you would stir us. We're starting a new series, but we're really not concerned about series. We're concerned about you. And we believe, Jesus, that you have some rebuilding that you desire to do in this new season. So I pray, God, that you would activate faith in us. I pray that you would quicken us by your Holy Spirit, that we would be able to hear, that we would be able to sense and see the places in our own lives where we need the restoration of God, Lord, and we're crying out to you for that. Lord, as we pray, even now, we would just say, God, this is your church. And Jesus, we want your church to reflect everything that you desire. So, Lord, burn away the old, burn away the dross, burn away the things that are not pleasing to you, and elevate the things that are close to your heart. Cause us to be humble, Lord, even as we reach out to you. And Lord, as we sing this hymn to simply tell you how much we need you, Lord, we would just simply say today, we really mean that. We really believe that. And we pray that you would meet us in a special way. So, church, even as we sing in worship, let me just encourage you to keep this prayer on your heart. Lord, we need you. Lord, we're asking for your presence. And I believe he will honor that as we reach out to him today. Let's sing together. Team, would you lead us as we close our service in worship?
Yeah, I would invite you to simply join us as we sing verses 1 and 2 of hymn number 564 in that spirit that Pastor Aaron just led us in, just a closer walk with thee.
Oh,
church in that same posture of prayer. Closer walk with thee, Lord, let it be. We invite you to stay here and to pray. We invite you to join. The prayer team will be coming up front. If you're joining us online, we invite you to click that request prayer button, and someone's there to pray with you as well. There's also prayer cards. You can submit those in the drop boxes in the back. Receive this scriptural benediction this morning from 2 Corinthians 13 that reads this way. It says, "Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you." In Jesus' name, let that be our prayer. Amen. Thank you.